Hey everyone, and welcome back to another 3D Revolution. In this video, we're going to be looking at OctoPrint, how to set it up, how to run it, and how to use it to control your printer. You only need a handful of items to get up and running with OctoPrint, and I'll pop a link in the description below to each of them. The most important being the Raspberry Pi and a power supply for it. We'll look into this in more details later on. You'll need a micro SD card. This is a 32GB and should be more than enough for most people. And a USB cable to plug your printer into the Raspberry Pi. Now, if you're planning on watching your print remotely or running time lapses, you'll also need a camera. You can either use a Raspberry Pi cam, such as this, or you can use a standard USB webcam, such as this. I'd also thoroughly recommend that you either buy or print a housing for your Raspberry Pi to protect it from knocks and short circuits. However, Pis when running OctoPrint can overheat when in a housing, so it's best, if possible, to get some heat sinks and a small 5-volt fan to keep air flowing over it and keep it nice and cool. I'll be doing a separate video to show you how to put this together and build a nice housing for your OctoPrint. Now, there are a number of different Raspberry Pis available, but if you're running OctoPrint, you either need the 3B Plus or the 4. Anything smaller than that isn't powerful enough to run OctoPrint, and you're going to run into print issues. Now, let's take a look at the 3B Plus that I've got here. Along here, you have these pins. You can use these to control external devices. Unless you're adding an extra little fan, like I showed you earlier, we won't be needing these for OctoPrint, but it's just so you know what they are. On the base here, you've got 4 USB ports. You'll be using one of these for a USB camera if you've got it, and the other to connect it to your computer. Along this side, you've got a micro USB port. That's your power in. You can either power that via just a standard USB power socket on a computer or something like that, or via a direct mains plug. Finally, up here, you have the port for the Raspberry Pi camera. If you choose to go down that route rather than using a USB camera, this is where you'll be plugging it in, but again, we'll look into that later on. As I mentioned earlier, you've got a few different options when it comes to cameras. You could use the Raspberry Pi camera, which is nice and compact and super cheap. Unfortunately, the quality isn't amazing on these, but if you're just monitoring your prints and you're not worried about the quality being really good, these are more than good enough. If you're doing time lapses, however, you're probably better off using a USB webcam. Something like this Logitech here, where the quality is much better. Both will do the job, it just depends what's suitable for you. When using the Raspberry Pi camera, instead of using the USB ports on the side, you'll be connecting it via the ribbon connector here. The Pi camera comes as an exposed circuit board, just like this. On the back of it is a ribbon connector exactly the same as that on the Raspberry Pi itself. To use this, simply pull down the black connector slot, take your ribbon cable, ensuring that the pins are facing in the correct direction, slot inside the connector, and then push up the black clip to lock it in place. That's the camera connected. Now we just need to connect this to the Raspberry Pi itself. The same process here applies. Simply pull up the black clip, enter the ribbon cable, ensuring the pins are the correct way round, push in the black clip again, and the camera is now set up and ready to go. All that's left to do is to remove the lens protector. And that's the Raspberry Pi camera. The alternative is to use a USB webcam, such as this Logitech C920. It's a 1080p camera and has much better quality than the Raspberry Pi cam. I particularly like this design, as it has a standard camera thread on the base, allowing you to either connect it to a tripod or a magic arm such as this. I personally like using the magic arm, as it allows you to connect it either to the table or potentially the printer itself, and gives you the opportunity to get the exact angle you want, either to monitor your print or for a time lapse. Okay, now we're more familiar with the hardware, let's check out the software and start getting things set up. The software side of things with OctoPrint is nice and easy. The first thing you want to do is open up a browser on your computer and go to octoprint.org. Scroll down and you'll see a green download button. On this page, you'll be able to get the latest version of OctoPi, which you'll be putting onto the micro SD card for your OctoPrint. So click download there, and save that to the desktop. Scroll down again and you'll see a link saying Using Etcher. This is some software that we'll be using to flash the firmware onto the microSD card for the Raspberry Pi. So let's go ahead and click that link. And here we'll be able to download Etcher. It's available for Windows, macOS and Linux. Once that's downloading, we can close that window as we won't be needing the Etcher page anymore. On this OctoPrint page, it has all the information we'll need to get set up, but for now, let's open Etcher. Once it's installed, it should automatically open. As standard, it should automatically select your microSD card you've inserted in your computer here. If you haven't inserted it, put it in there now and select it from this menu. On the left, we need to select the zip file, the image that we've downloaded, to apply to the microSD card. Select the entire zip file, don't unzip it first, and select Open. Now we can just hit Flash. What this will do now is apply that image to the microSD card. Once that's complete, open the card on your computer and locate octopi-wpa-supplicant.txt. We need to edit this. If you're on a Windows computer, however, do not use WordPad, and if you're on a Mac, don't use TextEdit. Ideally, you want to use Notepad++ on Windows, but standard Notepad is fine if you don't have this yet. Once you're in here, you'll be inputting your Wi-Fi network details so the Raspberry Pi can connect to your local network. For most of you, it'll be the WPA-WPA2 secured section. If you're using a different sort of Wi-Fi security, you'll probably be aware of this and you just need to edit the relevant details below. For most of you, however, just delete the four hashes at the beginning of these lines here, changing put SSID here for the name of your Wi-Fi network. This is what you'd find when you're searching for your network from your phone. Underneath it, next to PSK, you need to replace put password here with the same password you'd use to connect to your Wi-Fi network with your phone. Once you've done that, you can just hit save and close. For now, that's everything we need to do with this card, so you can eject it and get it ready to insert into the Raspberry Pi. To do this, simply turn over your Raspberry Pi and slot the card into the port at the end. Now you can plug in your power supply and turn it on. The red indicates that it's connected to power. The greeny yellow will flash quickly when you've connected to your Wi-Fi network. You now need to connect to your Raspberry Pi via SSH. To do this, you need a SSH client. On Windows, we would recommend PuTTY. You can download this via just typing in PuTTY on Google. And the first or second link that comes up should take you to this page here, where it can be downloaded for 32 or 64-bit. If you're on Mac, there is also a PuTTY for Mac. Just type in PuTTY for Mac on Google. And the first link that comes up should take you to PuTTY for Mac. Okay, now let's open up PuTTY. In the hostname or IP address section, if this is the first and only instance of OctoPi you've got at home, you should just be able to type in octopi.local. However, if you've got multiple OctoPrints running at home, you're going to need to find out what the IP address is for your new Raspberry Pi. The easiest way to do this is to log into your router and find the new device and get the IP address from there. For now, however, we should just be able to type this in and click OK. This has opened up an SSH window into our Raspberry Pi, and we're now communicating with it via PuTTY. We need to log in, so the username is Pi, P-I, and the password is Raspberry. Don't worry, as no letters are appearing as you type in the password. On SSH, this is just what it does to maintain secure. Click Enter, and as long as you've entered it correctly, it'll then log us in. The next thing we need to do is type sudo space raspi-config, and then just hit enter. We then need to re-enter the password Raspberry one more time and hit enter. We're now in the settings window for the Raspberry Pi. Here there's a few settings that we can change. The first thing that we should do is change the password. This will ask you to change the password for the Raspberry Pi user. Click OK. Enter a new password, obviously something that you can remember, but something that's also very secure. Hit enter and then re-enter the same password again. You've now changed the password in your Raspberry Pi and it's a lot more secure. Now there's a few other things that we can change here. The next thing to check is the language and region setting to make sure that it's set up for the right time and location. So go down to that and click enter. Go down to change time zone and ensure that it's set for the right geographical area and city where you are. Once that's done, we can click down and select network options. Click host name and click enter again. Now here we can change the name that it appears under your browser. Currently, you go to octopi.local to select your printer, but we could change this to ender3.local, for example, as that's what I'm setting this up for now. Let's change this to ender3. Click tab and click enter. And that's everything we need to do on this window, so we can now tab all the way down to finish and click enter. Click yes for reboot. The party will come up with an error now, but that's fine. That's because we've restarted the Raspberry Pi. We can click OK and close party. Give your Pi a minute to reboot, and then in the browser, visit the name you've given it, for example, octopi.local, ensuring that you enter http://// beforehand. We are now loaded onto your OctoPrint server. It will automatically come up with your setup wizard, and this will get it set up to work with your printer in particular. So we can start out by clicking Next. And here, you need to enter a new set of usernames and passwords. Rather than before, which was logging into the Raspberry Pi itself, this is to log into OctoPrint. Remember, in theory, you could have this as accessible from the web, so you need to make sure this is kept secure. Enter a username, a password, and then re-enter your password. And I thoroughly recommend that you select Keep Access Control Enabled to help prevent anyone hacking into your printer and taking over, which can be dangerous. Click Next, and you'll be taken to the Configure Anonymous Usage Tracking page. I usually enable this unless I'm finding it's causing me issues. Now we look at the connectivity check. I usually leave this at a 15-minute interval, and everything else can be left the same as well. Just click Enable Connectivity Check, and then we're good to go with this one. The plugin blacklist processing is quite a good thing to enable, helping to ensure that you don't accidentally install a plugin that's harmful or causes issues with your Raspberry Pi or OctoPrint. Just go ahead and click Enable and then Next. Finally, we need to set up for your printer itself. Give your printer a name here. Make sure that you've selected the right type, and we go on to Print Bed and Build Volume. Enter the right details for your printer here. It's essential to make sure that you put all of these details in correctly for your specific printer. The origin will usually be wherever the end stops are on each axis. Then move on to the axes. The speeds here can usually be left as they are, but you want to make sure that the inverted control is ticked correct for your specific printer. And finally, the hot end and extruder setting. Ensure that you've got the correct nozzle diameter and number of extruders entered. Now we can finish the setup wizard. Click Finish on the bottom right-hand side. Okay, OctoPrint is all set up and good to go. Let's take a look at how to use it. As this is a fresh install, you're going to want to check that you're running the latest version. So click the spanner at the top and go down to Software Update. If there is one available, it will come up in the menu here and just click Update. It will then show you which version you're looking at updating to. Ensure it's a stable version to prevent running into problems. It will now update the version of your OctoPrint and restart. When it restarts, you'll get a disconnection error, but click Attempt to Reload and then it'll reload the page for you. This may take a couple of minutes. Great, now we're all updated, let's take a look at the user interface. If you scroll down to the Files section on the left and click Upload, we can select some G-code. You can upload either directly to the Raspberry Pi or to the SD card inside your printer. Each have their own advantages and disadvantages, but I usually just upload to the Pi. Here's our uploaded G-code. You can download from here, delete it, load it ready for printing, or load and print. Currently, these two are grayed out. That's because we're not currently connected to the printer itself. On the connection section, ensure that your serial port is either directly connected or select auto. Ensure your baud rate is correct or select auto. Select the printer profile you set up earlier. And to make life easier in the future, select auto connect on server startup, then click connect. Once it connects, the window will likely hide itself, but then below in the state window, you'll see it states operational. We now have the ability to use our printer, and you can see that these two functions are now available. On the right hand side here, we have our temperature graph and controls. The window at the top here is our graph showing the actual and target temperatures for both the bed and the hot end, and then at the bottom we have the controls for both the hot end and the bed. For the tool, if I was to set, for example, 200 degrees and click the tick, you can see that the target for the hot end has now gone up to 200 degrees. If we give it a second, you can see the actual temperature start to rise. I don't actually want to heat with that for now, so let's go back to zero, click enter, and you can see the target is instantly dropped off. The next tab, control, we can see the view from our webcam. We can also control the various axes of the printer here, not only the X, Y, and Z axes, but we can also control the extrusion from here, ensuring your printer is up to temperature first, of course. Below each of those groups of settings, you can also control the speed and distance of each click move. On the right hand side, you've got general settings for fans and motors, turning them on and off independently. The next tab is G-code viewer. Once you've loaded some G-code, you'll be able to view the file layer by layer here, though it can struggle with larger files. The next tab is terminal. Here you'll see a live feed of all G-code sent from your Raspberry Pi to your printer, and you can also manually enter your own G-code commands yourself. The final tab is for time lapses. I'll be doing a separate video soon specifically on how to do time lapses on OctoPrint. Let's go back to the original tab and load some G-code. If you click the small folder button, it will load the G-code ready to print. The state window will now show various details about the print and will keep updating as it progresses. Now we're ready to hit print. As you can see, we start getting the amount of the file that's printed and the time will adjust as the print continues.
Well, that's everything ready to go with OctoPrint. I hope you found this video useful, and please hit subscribe if you'd like to see more. Don't forget, every item I've talked about in this video is linked in the description below. Thanks, and I'll see you guys next time.